Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to today's video, which is a product review for this Andycine 4K monitor. Now this is the model C7 and it supports HDMI only input, but you can get it in other versions which support SDI if you've got a camera that supports the pro level SDI output. So I've got it set up here on my Panasonic Lumix FZ2500, which is just a HDMI output. So I've got micro HDMI output from the camera to the standard HDMI input on the 4K monitor. Now this is a touchscreen monitor. It allows you to go through the setup screens using touchscreen, or you can use it as touch to focus, so you can actually ensure you've got perfect focus on the shot that you're taking. Now it is a 4K enabled HDMI monitor, but it supports standard definition and HD definition all the way from 24 frames per second up to 60 frames per second. In the 4K mode it supports 24 up to 30 frames per second, and if you're shooting in the DCI 4K mode, then you'll find you've got just 24 frames per second cinema mode with the monitor. So it supports all the common frame rates and formats that are available with modern digital cameras. Now it is supplied with this pivot arm, which has got a hot shoe attachment, so you could just slide that into your hot shoe on your camera. But I'm not in favour of putting anything like that on the hot shoe of my camera. One slight knock on here and it could destroy the hot shoe on your camera. So I prefer to put something of this weight on a small rig. And here I've got the actual small rig model, which I've attached the FZ2500 into. With having the pivot arm, it does mean that if you're using this to camera interview, you can actually tilt this forward and you can then film yourself and you can still see the screen. You can flip the screen horizontally and vertically so you've got the right orientation. You can see it's powered by the standard Sony NPF type battery, all the way from the 970 down to the 550 type batteries. Got a twin plate, so you can actually put two batteries in there if you wanted extra runtime. You can power it from an external 12 volt supply as well, which has got a 12 volt input jack, and you also got a 8.4 volt takeoff point, which you can use to power the camera, which I'm doing here. I've got a dummy battery box in the FZ2500, and that's being powered from the 8.4 socket on the unit. You only got output when the monitor's on. If you're in standby mode, then there's no power output from the monitor. It must be in a display mode to enable you to get the 8.4 volts out from the monitor. On the side of the unit here, we've got an on-off button, which also enables the touchscreen. So if you want the touchscreen on or touchscreen off, you can use this button to turn it on or off. On the top of the unit, there are three other function buttons: function 1, function 2 and function 3, and you can actually program those to whatever feature you want to enable it to work better for your particular type of setup. Now on the right hand side of the monitor there is a wheel which has got a push to operate as well. So if you turn this wheel, you find you can control the backlight. You click it in, it brings up the bottom menu. And across the bottom menu, we've got the grid, the safety marker, center marker, marker matte, false color. And if you've got a lookup table enabled camera, so something like a professional grade camera, or if you bought the lookup table for the FZ2500, you download the LUT, load that to your SD card, plug it into the SD slot on the side of the monitor here, and you can upload the SD file into the monitor, and then you can have the 3D LUT enabled in your camera. It is touchscreen, so if we double tap on the touchscreen, it brings up another sub menu here. If I tap that, you can see that we've got focus assist, zebra on off, monochrome, false color, return to the main menu. The on-screen time you can determined to be as long as you want. So here I've got on-screen time as 5 seconds. If I change that, if I just put up to 15 seconds while we just demonstrate some of the menus. So I double tap to bring up the menu. Top screen is focus assist. If I turn on focus assist, you can see we've got the adjustments for focus assist. Focus level allows you to set the sensitivity, if you like, of the focus level. focus color you can change from red, green, blue, white, yellow. So it enables you to set a color which is complementary to the scene that you're taking, so you can actually see that you've got perfect focus with the camera. So if I now move the camera focus point, so you can see the focus assist in operation from the camera, giving you the expanded display, and then we've got the focus assist of the camera itself. Back into the menu, turn focus assist off, got zebras on, and you can actually set the value of your zebra stripes. If you wanted them to be at where you've got 100% saturation, you can change this all the way from 1 up to 99 for the value of your zebra stripes. Also, we've got things like monochrome, so you can view this in monochrome rather than color. So you can actually change that to the red channel, green channel, or blue channel, or you bring it back to your standard grayscale. Turn monochrome off. You got false color if you wanted to make sure that you're recording correctly. The next menu down is the grid. So if we have the 3x3 matrix, if I turn that on, you can see on the screen we've got the horizontal and vertical matrix, which covers that 9 screen format. So we can actually make sure that we've got our composition element right. So we've got highs on the major thirds, etc. Safety marker. It's set to 70%, so we can actually change the screen marker here to make sure that we've got all our main content within the frame area. Again, turn that off if you wanted that off. Center marker, if you wanted the center marker position on, that is shown by the plus in the middle of the screen. The marker mat is the display screen for your aspect ratio. So the native aspect of this particular monitor is 1920 by 1200. So we have a 1610 format. So you can actually set the format here to be the CinemaScope 1610, or you can change it to your standard 16:9 if you're working in HDMI 4K or something like that. So you've got your 16:9 format there. You've got the overlay mat. Alpha, so you can actually change this to however bright you want it to be. You can turn it off, or you can turn it on to 75%. A really useful feature of this monitor is the ability to display the waveform. So if we just bring up the waveform and we go into the waveform menu, we can set the all the waves on, or we can just say set the parade, which is the RGB waveforms. So we can actually see the actual levels of RGB across the screen. If we want to look at the vector, so we want to make sure that our skin tones are correct, if we turn on vector, if we just go back here, you can see we've got the vector hover at this point. But if we turn the display RGB histogram, if we turn that on, come back, got the histogram. Unfortunately, you can't change the position of that, but you can if you go with all screen on. With all waves on, it now repositions the vectorscope, the RGB histogram, and your parade, so you can actually see them along with your image. Make sure you've got your skin tones right, so the line is across there, so we've got the correct skin tones being recorded by the camera. Our histogram shows us where we are in terms of exposure. We've got a volume level meter, which is coming from the camera HDMI and tells us we're actually down at minus 10. Useful displays if you want to get your exposures correct and you've got correct audio levels. So again, just double tap that to come up to there, and we can turn those off once we've got everything set. The next feature down is the operations for turning on the lookup table to enable you to import the SD card information. You can change the operational color temperature of the display from 5600 to 6500, or if you wanted the cooler display of 9300. So I would normally set mine to 5600, the standard for the Panasonic cameras. Backlight auto, we've got it in the auto mode, so it will actually change the intensity of the backlight dependent on the ambient light, which has been detected by a small sensor on the top. So as the ambient light changes, it will change the display backlight to maintain the same brightness. And then we've got, if you put this into the manual mode, you can change brightness, contrast, saturation, so you can actually set up the monitor. And in fact, if your camera supports something like the color bars, if I just turn on the color bars, you can actually make sure that you've got your contrast set correctly between the grays and the whites, to make sure you're correctly set up, so you can actually set your contrast, saturation and monitor illuminances to make sure everything's perfect when you set that up from your camera. You have an audio output jack on the side here as well if you wanted to monitor your audio, so that you will be able to monitor your audio. There is a slight delay because of the HDMI output from your camera through the inputs of this device, so you are to get a little bit of a delay, but it means you can monitor your audio to make sure you've got good audio. So that is filming indoors. Let me take the rig outdoors. We've got intermittent bright sunshine, so I should be able to see how this responds in bright sunshine. You can actually still see this display whilst the sun is out. So you can actually see the monitor is out now in full sun, and you can actually see the display is nice and bright. You can actually see all the information. If I just zoom in a little bit on that, you can actually see we've got good definition, and you can see the brightness and contrast on the monitor. And again, if we bring up things like the focus assist, we can make sure that we've got focus for our particular shot. And again, we can use our touch to zoom if we wanted to make sure that we've got focus in the point where we want. As you could see outside, the sun was actually directly on the screen of this Andycine C7 model, and you can actually see everything perfectly clear on that monitor. It does have HDMI out as well, so you can actually use this pass-through if you wanted to use it on a recording device, so you could actually use it to capture external video, as well as being able to display the correct exposure and your framing, etc., on the monitor. It is a IPS monitor, which has got an 80 degree viewing angle either side. So even though I'm stood off to the side, I can actually still see the monitor without any distortion in color or things like that. So an IPS panel is ideal in this sort of situation. So there we are. That is the Andycine C7 monitor. Fantastic little monitor. The monitor I've been using up to now has been very poor in outside light. You've had to put your coat around it to make sure you've got the right settings, etc. But this is an absolutely fantastic monitor for your colour work outside. Only negative I've got about this entire rig, that is not really with the monitor itself, it's the provision of the external power from the monitor. When you've got the battery installed on the monitor, you've got a little red LED light which indicates that you've got power available. You don't get any power to the actual display or your external camera supply until you turn the unit on. So press and hold that for just 3 seconds. The camera will power up and then your monitor will come on, and then you will get the display through HDMI. But if you turn the monitor off, it turns off the 8.4 volts as well, so it doesn't shut down your camera in an orderly fashion. So if I wanted the camera to shut down, you must shut the camera down first and then turn off the monitor. So by just turning off the camera will shut down in its normal manner, and then I can press and hold the button for 3 seconds and the monitor will turn off. Now, this was supplied to me by Andycine for the review, so full disclaimer there. But I have been absolutely delighted with the performance of the monitor. It is absolutely superb in terms of getting you the right colour and exposure. Compared to my previous MCO Plus monitor, I had to put a coat over my head, just like an old plate camera, to make sure that I had the right framing and exposure, etc. So this is a fantastic addition to my arsenal of kit to produce better videos for here on YouTube. So I will put links to the website where you can have a look at the full specifications for the product and make sure you're getting the right monitors for your particular operation, whether you need HDMI or the model that has SDI as well. So thanks very much for watching. Please do take care, and I hope to see you all in my next videos. Goodbye for now.